my name is Jim Leda, and I'm going to do aphasis using network analysis. This presentation will have the following structure. First, we will start with the motivation behind this work. Then we are going to present the measures and the quantum model that we have studied. And finally, we are going to analyze the results. First, quantum phase transitions are often characterized by quantum averages over physical samples, such as this open correlator. For example, in the transvertism model, we have a chain of qubits that has a nearest neighbor interaction and a transfer field. From this quantum phase transition can be characterized using these two point correlator and detect the phase transition from a ferromagnetic field and a paramagnetic phase. However, Dickard and co-workers propose a new paradigm, a new method to detect these quantum phase transitions using network analysis. Using network measures, they detect that several of these measures can also detect the phase transition. In our case, we apply this idea of network analysis to study a topological phase transition that is different from the work that Dickard did, because this phase transition doesn't present a spontaneous symmetry breaking. The first question that we can ask is, what is a network? A network can be defined as a structure that represents connections between distinct units. These units are called nodes, and the connections are called edges. There are different kinds of network. These different kinds of network can be, for example, the regular network, that is the case that we are studying. This kind of network present a highly ordered structure, and all the nodes have the same number of links. There are also complex networks that, for instance, in this case, we present the small word network that has a similar structure to the regular network, but there are some nodes that are randomly connected. Our network will be constructed from a closed chain of N2-level systems coupled to each other. So we will start with an example. Given a system with size 4, we can generate this network. This network has different weights. These weights are the reduced density matrices, and to compute this set of reduced density matrices, what we need to do is first to compute the ground state of the previous network. Given this ground state, we can compute these two expressions, and we will get the set of reduced density matrices. Now, once we have this measure, this network, we can construct three correlation measures. The first one is the network of mutual information that is given by this by this equation, and what it does is it measures the uncertainty between a subsystem of two particles. We can also construct a coherence network that what it does is it measures the sum of non-diagonal terms of the partial traits of the reduced density matrices. And finally, our last network that we are going to study is the concurrence network. That what it, to construct this network, we first need to compute this matrix, and these are the eigenvalues of these matrices. Finally, to figure out the structure of the network, we need to calculate some quantities. The quantities that we're going to calculate are these five measures. The first is the density. The density, what it does is it measures the amount of information that a certain node spreads to the to its neighbors. For example, the node A spreads more information than the node B, so we get this expression. And for example, now the disparity, what it does is it measures how this information is distributed. For example, B sends exactly the same information to this neighbor and to the other neighbor. But for example, B prime sends more information to this node. So we say that B prime has a higher disparity than B. Another coefficient is clustering. it's a ratio between the closed triplets and the sum of open and closed triplets. A closed triplet is three nodes that has three edges, and an open triplet will be three nodes that only has a connection with two edges. The average shortest path is the path that measures that minimizes the weight between two nodes. Then the diameter is just the shortest path, is the longest path among the set of possible shortest paths. Now we are going to present the Kitaev model. Given a chain of n sites that can be either occupied or unoccupied by a spinless fermion, the Hamiltonian that gives us the energy of this system is this equation from here, where the first term is the Hopping parameter that can be interpreted as the energy required to move one fermion to one neighbor site to the other. Then we have the chemical potential parameter, that is the energy required to excite one vacuum site. And finally, we have the superconductive term, that is the energy extracted to form a Cooper pair. A Cooper pair is just two neighbor sites that are or either occupied or unoccupied. Now, to study the bulk features of this of the Hamiltonian, we need to perform the Fourier transform, and then once we have done the Fourier transform, we need to calculate. We need to do the Hugo-Guess transform to get the same Hamiltonian with a diagonal form. Given this form, we can compute. We can plot the energy, the dispersion relation as a function of mu. Here we see that there are negative energies. These negative energies represent unoccupied sites or holes, and the positive energies represent occupied sites. As we see, there is always a gap between holes and occupied sites. But this gap it is closed at k equal p when these parameters. When this condition is satisfied. Now the question is, what happens when this gap closes? To answer this question, we are going to use topology. We are going to use topological arguments. Topology, what it does is it studies if there is a continuous transformation that can preserve the properties of the object. For instance, the fact that the gap closes is an indicator that there is not such continuous transformation in our case. So what it means is that the topology of our system will change in this, the topology of the system will be different in this region than in this other region. Now, to study the topological change, what we do is to compute the Bathian over the Bugoli of the genus Hamiltonian, that is this matrix over here, and the Bathian is just the square root of the determinant of this matrix. Computing the Bathian over the special case k equal p, we see that there is a chain of sign when mu is equal to omega. We can now define a topological invariant that we define it as the product of the Bathian of these two quantities, and we will see that our topological invariant is different in one region and in the other. We call the region that is our topological invariant is one, we will call it the trivial phase. And when it's minus one, we will call it the topological phase. If there is a topological, if there is a topological change, our ground state of the system should notice this, the change of topology. So what we do is to compute the overlapping function that is just the inner product between the first ground state at mu equal one and all the other ground states. So as we see in this plot, the overlapping function, as mu increases, the overlapping function decreases. What it means is that our ground state is different here than here. We also see that the overlapping function is zero at this region. This has another meaning that in this region the ground state belongs to a different symmetry sector than the ground state from here. So we have two topological regions, this one and this other one. In order to see if this system is robust, we apply a spatial disorder to the chemical potential. Even if we apply this spatial disorder, we can notice that there is two topological regions, one here and the other. As we see here, as we expected, adding a spatial disorder, what it does is to shift the quantum transition from mu equal to omega to another point near this critical point. In our case, we are going to study this regular lattice. If we apply this spatial disorder, we see that the structure changes, and this will be a study that we will do in a future project. Now, we are going to start analyzing the results. First, let me introduce let me explain this picture. Now, here what I plot is the weight value as a function of the distance between two nodes. For example, this node, this point, it represents the weight between 0 and 1. This represents the weight between 0 and 2, and so on. So, as you see, there are different colors. The different color represents different values of the chemical potential, and this region from here corresponds to the topological phase. This region, the region at the bottom, corresponds to the trivial phase. And we can see that there is clearly a transition. There is a different weight distribution when we reach the critical point. So we see that there is a transition from this weight distribution to the other weight distribution. The measures we see that are consistent with the previous plot. For example, the density and the disparity are able to capture the topological phase transition and are consistent because, for example, the disparity is lower in the topological phase because the weight distribution is flat, as we have seen in the other slide. The clustering and the shortest path are also able to detect the phase transition, and as we see, the clustering coefficient decreases as a function of the chemical potential, except for the for this parameter. And this parameter presents a non-monotonical behavior because it starts to increase until it reaches a point of mu equal 1.74. That we need to compare measures to characterize or to know really what happens here. Okay. Now, For a system size, for an intermediate system size, we see that all the measures are able to capture a gap between between the two topological faces. For example, the clustering coefficient decreases as a function as the size of our chain is increasing, and also it, the clustering coefficient decreases a little bit when the delta parameter is large. This case can be explained as if we have a Cooper pair, the delta value, what it does is to increase the thickness of this bound. So if the thickness of this bound increases, the clustering coefficient that we have seen previously, what it does is to see this closed trigger as an open trigger because this link becomes irrelevant. The weight distribution for the coherence network is more is very similar to the mutual information, and all the measures are able to detect the topological phase transition. This network measure, this network correlation, doesn't provide new information about the structure of the KitaF chain. Finally, we are going to see the concurrence network. This concurrence network, what it measures is entanglement between two particles. In this plot, we see that at large value of the delta parameter, the concurrence vanish at distance 2. That is the expected behavior of the entanglement. But when the delta parameter is low, we see that the concurrence persists even in at large distance. Not even is it persists and it also increases as the distance goes higher. So to explain this behavior, I draw this picture that what it represents is different Cooper pairs. Applying the principle of minimum energy, I imagine that the chain, what it does is to form this structure where that can explain why the system is so entangled, because all the particles form Cooper pairs. But this doesn't explain why at distance 7 or at distance 6 there are the concurrence is higher than at distance 2 or 3. To explain this phenomena, what we need to do is to remember that that we are applying periodic boundary conditions, so the node 6 is affected by node 1 in this direction, and it also is affected in this direction. On the contrary, node 3 or 4 is only affected by node 1 in this direction, because this other direction is irrelevant in comparison. In the case of the concurrence, the density is is the only measure that is able to capture the topological phase transition for all the delta parameters. The other measures, as the disparity, is not able to capture the phase transition for these two parameters. Only for delta equal to 1/2 is able to detect a transition. There is a persistent point at mu equal 1.74 that we need to perform more measures and scale the system to see if this point can be scaled up or can be generalized in some way. Again, in the clustering coefficient, we see that there is a peak at the same value, and the only value that is able to detect a topological phase transition is the delta parameter at 1/2. Now, again, plotting the gap size, that is the distance between one topological phase to the other, we see that the clustering coefficient is not a good measure because we think that it's not robust enough since it doesn't present a smooth behavior. What it means is that if we increase the size of the network, probably this clustering coefficient will be zero at some point, and the gap will be closed. At delta 2, only the density parameter is able to capture the jump between one phase transition, between the topological phase transition and the trivial phase transition. All the other parameters are not able to detect it. Finally, the conclusions. Network analysis can characterize also, we see that network analysis can also characterize topological phase transitions. Data generated by correlation measures such as mutual information coherence and concurrence show that the network analysis can be useful to understand the underlying physics of the topological quantum system. Even in the presence of noise, the system presents two topological phases, then the system is robust. And another conclusion is that we can detect points that are not in the analytical solution as the point of mu equal 1.74. To extend this project, we are going to start with the open boundary conditions case and also apply noise to the system, apply spatial distortion to the system. This is the slide that I want to show you. Thank you.
So now